Hello everyone, welcome to our service today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Barry Wilson. I'm a retired priest helping out here at St. Luke's in Leek. And this week I'm covering for Matt, who's having a few days off. As you may know, his parents were injured in an accident last weekend. They're home from hospital now, but still quite severely injured. So please do keep them in your prayers through this coming week. As you can see, we are going to be using our green service book today. But this is the last week which we shall be doing so for a while. Next Sunday is the first Sunday in Lent, and I presume we're going to switch to our purple service booklets. If you haven't got one at home and you'd like one so that you can follow the service and join in, if you let Matt know, I'm sure he'll arrange to have one delivered to you as soon as possible. We will be having communion today, or at least as near to communion as we can get in these difficult times. So if you'd like to be part of that, if you'd like to use the symbols of bread and wine to share in communion together, then please do go to get some bread and wine now. You can pause the video and then pick up again when we get back. Our first hymn is Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. The Lord be with you, and also with you. We pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. We come now to our time of confession, where we receive that forgiveness Christ won for us on the cross all that time ago. A few moments of quiet then, as we reflect back over this past week and bring to mind those things of which we're particularly aware of our need for God's forgiveness today. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, as God's forgiven people, we give glory to his name in the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Now, a few moments of quiet as we bring ourselves and our own prayers to God this morning. A collect for the first Sunday, the last Sunday before Lent. Almighty Father, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us grace to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to suffer with him and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now we go over to Christine, who's going to bring us our Bible reading, and then to Rachel, who will be preaching for us today.
The reading is taken from 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verses 11 to 16. When Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord and the royal palace, and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, "I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people, who are called by name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
If ever there was a verse for our times, a word in season, if you will, then this passage from 2 Chronicles chapter 7 is pretty much it, isn't it? I mean, we're all right for rain, not being too rainy, and so far, no locusts. But as for the plague, bingo, this is a word for our times. Let's just put it in context a little bit. King Solomon, son of David, has just finished building this spectacular temple in Jerusalem as a place where God has promised to dwell among his people, where he would meet them and listen to their prayers and forgive their wrongdoings. Solomon has asked God, he'd prayed to God in this big public dedication ceremony to remember his promise to his people. And in this passage, God replies. And it's interesting to me that when he replies when Solomon is alone at night and possibly some considerable time after the initial dedication ceremony in which this massive public prayer was made. So that's an interesting detail. This is what he says in verses 14 through to 16. He says, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there." What God says there is hugely encouraging and helpful and challenging. And it's a message for us, his people, who are called by his name. It's encouraging because, first and foremost, it's a promise. It's a covenant between God and his people, us. And I believe, I have to believe, that God keeps his promises. He's faithful. He can be trusted above and beyond any other thing in the whole of creation. God will never let us down. He promises that he's going to see us and hear us, and that his heart will always be with us in his temple. By which he doesn't mean a building on Novi Lane or Fountain Street, thank goodness, otherwise this verse would not be particularly encouraging at the moment. What does he mean by his temple? He means us. We are his temple. If you look back at last week's verse in Ephesians chapter 2, we can see that Paul is writing and telling us that we who are in Christ are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. The whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. We are his temple now. Wherever we are in his Spirit, his Spirit in us guarantees his attentive, open-hearted presence with his people. And the Holy Spirit is a seal of his promise to us to hear us, to forgive us, and to heal us. This passage is also helpful because in it, the Lord sets out a clear set of circumstances that we can act on that underpin his promise. Things that we need to get right if we're going to fully benefit from his promise. We've got to play a part, haven't we? Because God doesn't do things to us. We've got to be in it to win it. We need to participate. So what is it that we need to do? And there are four very clear things. Firstly, we need to humble ourselves. Humble ourselves. What do you think of when you think about humbling yourself? We're humble, we're humble, we're very, very humble, like Uriah Heep and Charles Dickens. Is it that thing where we used to do this when we were messing about when we were children, where we hold the door open for each other and say, after you, no, 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 after you, no, no, after you, I insist. And each one trying to get below the other one. Is it that thing that you do where you take yourself down a peg or two, where you can't hear a positive thing about yourself? You just can't accept any praise. You've just got to put yourself down until your self-esteem is right down there in the basement. Is that humility? Not sure that it is. I don't think that's what God means in this passage. I think humbling ourselves is about acknowledging who we really are, what our place is in God's creation. Listen, this is the important thing. We are not in charge. Humankind was not designed to do this life thing on our own. We were designed to do life following the Creator's instructions. And if we as Christians struggle with this bit, and let's face it, we really do struggle, how much more humankind as a whole? No wonder we're in the mess that we're in. We get destruction, disease, injustice, warfare, because we insist that we're able as a species to run this world without reference to the one who made it. Hubris, the Greeks called it. An excessive pride and defiance of the gods leading to nemesis. To be humble is to acknowledge your need for God, and it's the starting point of a real relationship with him, from which our lives can really start to grow. You are not in charge. You never have been. And the sooner you realise it, the better off you'll be. It's a massive relief, if nothing else. So, one, humble yourself. Two, pray. And this is what our lockdown lesson is really about this week. Prayer. We've been learning so much about prayer over this last year, haven't we? I'd love to hear what's been going on for you, what you've been learning. I'm sure that every single one of us has had our own experiences, our own revelations and frustrations. Maybe if you felt moved to do so, you'd get in touch with me and let me know what you've been thinking. I'd be so interested to hear what you've been learning about prayer over this last year. As for me, it's been pretty much a roller coaster ride. There's been some amazing high points where God has been so present and so active that it's almost taken my breath away, to those kind of depths of the kind of a soul lockdown where I haven't even dared to open my mouth or my heart to him because I've been too scared to get an answer that I didn't understand or like, or not to feel like I've got an answer at all. Then I've been confused when I can't even begin to understand how he can allow things to happen. And then I've been amazed, and then the sheer elation of seeing his hand so clearly working to shine light into the darkness and to bring hope where there was despair. Sometimes it's just been so overwhelming, hasn't it, to to just have the number of people and situations where there's been such trouble that we've wanted to lift up to God. And sometimes it's been really hard to remember that prayer isn't just a list of things and situations and people that we want God to fix. I've been reminded of that just this week. I've been looking at Pete Gregg's work again on how to pray. It's the work of the movement called 24 Prayer 24/7, which we studied in our home group a little while ago, which is just absolutely brilliant. I really recommend it to you. And there's a book called How to Pray. And also, if you have the YouVersion Bible app, there's a 21-day study that you can do that will just get into some of this stuff. There's some of this basic stuff about how to pray. Or indeed, you can do it as a small group in your home group. It's got some just really helpful basic pointers which just underpin the whole area of prayer. And one of the most important things that he says that has really stuck with me is just a three thing. It's a keep it simple, keep it real, and keep it up. It doesn't have to be posh, it doesn't have to be flowery, it's just a simple conversation between you and God. But keep it real, it has to be authentic. And keep it up, don't stop, don't give up, don't stop. The bottom line is this, isn't it? If we want to benefit from God's promises, the things that he promises to do for us, then we have to pray, because we have to build our relationship with him. And that's what prayer is. As Pete Gregg says, prayer is relational, not transactional. It's about building relationship. It's not about what we can get from God. It's what being a Christian is all about, isn't it? Having a real transformational relationship with God our Father. When we realise what he's done for us in Jesus' death and resurrection through the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. We can't do that stuff without prayer. And so we come to the third part of our side of the deal. Seek his face. Seek his face. Do you know that feeling? That feeling when you're standing in the presence of God in worship, so aware of his presence that you can feel the joy and the love of his gaze as he enjoys your praise of him. Oh, I pray that you know that. I pray that we can all remember a time in our life when we've truly seen and been seen. Or maybe we've witnessed that precious look of love between a parent and their baby. Pure love and acceptance, unconditional, joy-giving love in the eyes of our beloved. Fleeting moments may be, but our Father knows our need of them. And he knows that without that deeply personal reassurance of his love for us, we can quickly forget who we are to him. We need to seek his face for many reasons, mostly just because he deserves it, but also because it puts everything else into perspective. To say out loud that God is God and he is awesome, to remember his character and his majesty, to claim his promises and to acknowledge his faithfulness, and to stand before him because of Jesus is a powerfully moving thing, even when times are really hard, and perhaps even more so because times are really hard. And it's an active thing. We need to choose it. To seek implies effort, adventure, challenge. And it has been a challenge, hasn't it? Now that our worship life is so different from anything that it has been before, and I know many of us have been really, really struggling with this. It's been really painful, hasn't it, not to be able to worship in the way that we've been used to worshipping, not to be able to go and find God where we've been used to finding him. And that's been, for many of us, together in church. I don't know about you, but I've been forced to ask myself some really tough questions about my desire, my determination to seek him in new places, in different ways. And what is it that I'm really seeking? Is it God's face? Or is it the spiritual high of being together in worship? Or is it the togetherness of the warm fuzziness of being with my Christian brothers and sisters? All of which are wonderful things. Listen, God is still God. He still deserves all my praise and adoration. When the music fades and all is stripped away, what do I bring that will bless his heart? Although I love it, and although God loves it too, and although it does us so much good, it's got to be about more than the song. And that's the challenge for us right now. Although, when I do get the chance to sing, aren't I grateful for it? Aren't I grateful for Jerry? Aren't I grateful for the worship that he brings us through his music? Oh my goodness, I am. And when I do get that opportunity, I'm going to stand up and I'm going to grab it with both hands. I'm going to sing. I'm going to lift my voice. I'm going to take that opportunity with as much gusto as I can, because it's up to me to put myself in a place where I am actively seeking his face. Because here's another promise of God: you will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, God is always there to be found. We just need to keep on seeking. And lastly, we need to repent. We need to repent. Anything that's not God's way is the wrong way, and all of us have got things in our lives and our attitudes and our actions and our choices that are not God's will for us. And that's what we need to turn away from, whether we think of our ways as wicked or not. Holding things back from him is just not going to work. It's just going to create a barrier to his promises that only you can choose to remove. A massive part of prayer is bringing our lives, our relationships, our concerns to God and letting go of our priorities so that his priorities, his way, can take precedence. We've just got to hand over that authority, which never really was ours to begin with. And when we do this, we can very quickly begin to see that we need to turn away what it is that we need to turn away from and where we need to focus instead. It's inevitable, isn't it, that when we recognise and acknowledge our need for God and we start to really communicate with him and to spend time in his wonderful presence, we're going to want to turn away from whatever doesn't please him. It sounds simple. But this is why this passage is not only encouraging and helpful, it's also really challenging. Because there are all sorts of reasons why our relationships with God may have become strained, sort of distant over this last time. We've lost our routines and our habits. We're suffering. We are confused, feeling a bit lost in the darkness. We're maybe angry or just plain disappointed. All of which makes praying feel like a long way from the top of our to-do list. And it's really important, isn't it, to remember that we're not the first ones or the only ones to have ever felt this way. I've been reading Job recently and some of the Psalms, and those folk were really going through it. They were not having a good time, but they trusted in God's promises rather than in their circumstances, as Barry was saying last week. They believed and they repeated what God's people have known all through the generations, that God is good and his love and yours forever. But honestly, really, we have never needed prayer more, have we? Both as individuals, as a country, as inhabitants of planet Earth, we need prayer. It's not just challenging, it's a challenge. The world needs us to pray because look what God has promised. He will forgive us and he will heal our land. And I believe that God keeps his promises. Let's pray. God our Father, maker and sustainer of all things, we thank you that in your grace you have promised to meet us and to hear us, to forgive us and to heal us. We thank you that because of Jesus, we can always be in your wonderful presence and we can know the joy and power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Help us to humble ourselves, to pray, to seek your beautiful face and to turn away from all that displeases you so that we can know the full blessing of your promise to us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Food for thought there. Let's commit ourselves to spending more time with God in prayer through this Lenten period. Now we profess our faith in God in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom shall have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now we come to God in prayer. Thank you. As we come to the communion part of the service, if you haven't yet got bread and wine and you want to share, then please do so now. I'll just pause the video and we'll pick up again at the piece. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross, and here today we meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Today we shall use Eucharistic Prayer H on page 16. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. body of Christ keep us all in eternal life. And the blood of Christ keep us all in eternal life. And so we pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gates of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And our final hymn today is, Father, hear the prayer we offer. Thank you for being with us today. We hope you've enjoyed our worship and you've met with God despite the difficulty of our situations today. And now we close with a prayer of blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. So now let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.